21st, 2016. Jody, if you could leave us in the pledge, lead us in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dolores.
Counselor Bello is absent. Counselor Hemmen?
Here.
Counselor Hurley?
Here.
Counselor Latina?
Here.
Counselor Martino?
Here.
Counselor Rell?
Here.
Counselor Spinella?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Barry?
Here.
And Mayor Montaneri?
Here. Thank you, Dolores.
Thank you.
We have a couple of presentations this evening before public comment. We're going to start with the Keene Family Foundation, which is here for a presentation. Judy? Yes, please. The floor is yours.
I'm Judy Keene, and I'm a resident of Wethersfield, and I'm also president of the Richard M. Keene Foundation in town. And we work very hard all through the year to provide programs for the community. And this year, our annual carnival was very successful, in great part because of our fabulous board members, some of who are here, and I'd like them to stand up in a minute. But we also had three beautiful days, and that is really the criteria for a carnival. So I'd like to, with Mark Trahan, who is the chairman of the carnival each year, come up here, Mark, present Paul. The mayor and the members of social services, Kathy Bagley and Erica Texera. We'd like to present you with a check for $19,000. Wow. Like I say, it's in a large part due to our board members who are here. So Howie Ray Black, Darcy O'Connor, Barb Bellis, and Nia Crawfield. If you'd all come up here, please, too, and we'll get maybe a picture.
Jody is coming around.
Thank you. She's taking the check. She gave it to the right person. So we'll do. Thank you.
It's from Donna.
Okay. Thank you to that group. I think it goes without saying how generous Judy and her team is every year to the town. It's an amazing story. We have representation from the MDC here this evening. I think folks are aware that there is a topic that has been getting some attention throughout the 8-member towns surrounding Hartford with regard to the ad valorem, concerns about Hartford's ability to meet some of those expectations for the sewer charge. And there are several mayors who have been involved with meetings over the last month or so, and MDC, in response to some of the pending resolutions, have been kind enough to come out this evening, give us a little bit of a summary of the status of it at this point, and I think give the council a full opportunity to, I guess, hear some of that, and I'm sure we'll have some questions. So, John, you have the floor. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor and members of the council. First, I kind of just want to give some background as to how the situation arrived and how we got to this point, and then I can walk through some of the numbers that we were talking about, that about the what we're proposing in our 2017 budget. The current necessity for planning for the situation was brought about by the City of Hartford, as you are all aware of and you've been reading in the media, is suffering financial distress. And the city officials under the Bronin administration believe that the best solution for its financial distress is in the actions that can only be taken by the state legislature. which basically, as we know, convenes in January. In the fiscal 17, the City of Hartford's municipal fiscal 17, which ends June 30th, Hartford has budgeted its ad valorem taxes to the MDC and has stated that it intends to pay the January and April 2017 payments. Hartford's budget for the next fiscal year, starting July 1st of 2017, going through June 30th, 18, is not yet prepared, and they cannot make that commitment at this point in time due to their financial condition. As a result, the MDC is on a fiscal calendar year. Our calendar year starts January 1st and ends December 31st, 2017, so we're here at our budget adoption process. So we're the first out of the gate, so we have to develop a plan that addresses the potential consequences of the Hartford's financial distress, which could include missing payments in Hartford's fiscal 2018, which would be our July of 17 and October of 17 payments due from the City of Hartford. Based upon the current MDC's charter, the MDC does not have an ability to enact a supplemental budget after December 31st, other than for unforeseen expenses that would need revenues, but it does not allow the MDC to adopt a supplemental budget for gaps in revenue, if the City of Hartford misses a payment, that would be a gap in revenue as opposed to an actual increased expense item. The MDC cannot borrow for working capital currently under its charter. Its charter enables the borrowing powers for the MDC solely for capital purposes. Other than the ability to issue a levied tax revenue for a period no longer than 6 months, that's the only other opportunity that the MDC has to borrow anything other than for capital purposes. The MDC must operate its sewer operations largely from and separate from its water utility operations. The MDC's general fund is its sewer operations. There's a separate proprietary enterprise fund for the water utility, so the revenues are separate and distinct, as well as the expenses, which is making this situation a little more difficult. Is that MDC currently has $113.5 million worth of bond anticipation notes, which are maturing on December 1st of 2016. And the MDC plans to pay for these obligations, these bond anticipation notes, through the issuance of its $173.5 million GO bond sale, which was contemplated for November of 2016. And the financial community, in addition to the rating agencies, as well as the folks in Wall Street and the bond buyers, are looking for the MDC to address any potential Hartford default in the payment. The uncertainty already over the Hartford situation has cost the MDC a downgrade in its ratings. We were dropped one notch by both Moody's and S&P on the rating that was applied for this GO bond issue. As well as you also may have been reading, the bond market has been rather unsettled since the unexpected results of the election and has been very volatile. And a lot of the potential buyers are being very selective in what they buy, given the volatility. This has resulted in the forecasted borrowing costs to be much more costly than was originally anticipated. So getting to the 2017 budget, the MDC intends to pass a budget and issue a tax warrant that allows the MDC's annual tax at a level that will provide sufficient revenues to operate the MDC sewer operations in the event that the Hartford misses its payments. This would require the other seven member towns to pay slightly higher ad valorem tax to compensate for Hartford's inability to pay if that comes. The reserve that was originally contemplated was much larger. The reserve that is being proposed for the 2017 budget for consideration now only is putting a reserve for the fiscal 18 payments for the City of Hartford, which is the July 2017 and the October 2017 payments. If these additional sums are not collected, if they're collected and the City of Hartford eventually pays, the money will be refunded back to the member towns. Through this process, the MDC has incorporated suggestions that are made by the other member towns through numerous meetings that were held during the budgetary process starting in September, and the latest we had as a group was last Thursday. During this period, the MDC did consider other suggestions, and after reviewing them, we determined that they were probably not feasible, and just some of them were, you know, obviously we were asked to consider the passing of supplemental budget, which, as I said, we could not do because there was no unforeseen expense associated with this item. The discussion of issuance of tax anticipation notes, we're only allowed to issue them for a period not to exceed 6 months based upon our charter, and it has to be supported by, you know, levied tax revenue to come. If there is no reserve in the plan, those tax anticipation notes would not be marketable, because if we were trying to issue a TAN on a City of Hartford's payment that they didn't make, what is the security? Another payment that they may not make. So therefore, we need the reserve in place in order to make them marketable. Also, the member towns suggested guaranteeing the TANs if we issued them in absence of a City of Hartford payment or if there was no reserve. This would require the member towns to make an appropriation for the amount in their budget anyway, so it achieves the same result as the reserve. Also, we reviewed if the towns would issue an agreement of memorandum signed by the member towns to make the deficient payments in the event that Hartford defaults. But this, once again, can only be if it be feasible if it's issued in a tax warrant, so it basically achieves the same outcome as a reserve and credit model. So specifically to Wethersfield, the overall general ad valorem increase was 7%. The 2016's adopted ad valorem was $38.9 million, and the proposed base ad valorem was $41.7 million. As you recall, the ad valorem is allocated to the member towns based upon the formula contained in the MDC's charter, which is the proportionate share of the sum of the prior three-year cash receipts. This year, the 2017 percentage for Wethersfield dropped from prior year's 8.24 down to 8.18%, so the base ad valorem increase for Wethersfield is 6.25%. As I mentioned before, the 2017 budget also contemplates a reserve equivalent to the two payments of the City of Hartford, which would be July and October of 2017. Those two payments for the City of Hartford are $2,937.85, so just let's call it, you know, $5,975,000, so just a hair under $6 million. So the formula for determining the reserve is you take those two payments and you divide them by the City of Hartford's share, one minus the City of Hartford's share. The current share for City of Hartford is 26.31%. So you gross that payment up so that that little under $6 million becomes a reserve of $7.97 million, of which is then assessed to all eight member towns based upon the ad valorem. So the portion assessed to the seven member towns is $5,875,750, of which Wethersfield is assessed $652,241, bringing the grand total of the 2017 base ad valorem and two payments reserved to $4,060,441. As I said, as that payment, the reserve payment would be due, let me just stand back up just 1 second, as you may be familiar that the MDC's ad valorem payments are quarterly payments due on January 18th, April 19th, July 19th, October 18th. Normally, those are our four quarterly payments. They're basically I think it's the Thursday and the third week of each of those months. We're proposing that the reserve payment be paid on October 25th of 2017. So the City of Hartford has committed that it would pay its first two payments of a little over about $5.1 million. So the net amount for the collection, the MDC would collect the additional, hopefully, $8 million or $5.9 million. In the event that the City of Hartford makes its July payment, that it would be credited automatically. The tax warrant resolution that the MDC's board is considering is in the event that the City of Hartford makes the payments, there's an automatic credit so that my finance staff could notify the member town's finance staff and say, hey, Hartford made its payments. There will be no payment due in October. What I'd like to reference is we had the other model, how this worked with the six payment stream on the website, so you can see it, but we will be posting this version I'm reading from up on the website shortly. And that's kind of how we got here and how the mechanics are working, and at this point, I just turn it over to you for any questions.
Yeah, so, Councilor Jody?
Sure. John, I didn't catch your last name. I'm sorry.
Zinzarella.
Thank you. Question. So the assessment plus the ad valorem tax that Wethersfield would owe because of this model that you're proposing, what is the total that we would have to come up with?
For the for NDC's fiscal 2017, Wethersfield would be $4,060,441.
And let's say that Hartford doesn't pay those last two and you have to use the reserve. You're saying that we would be reimbursed down the road when they would pay?
When they would pay, or if part of these things that the MDC would, this is kind of a backstop for the credit solution for the MDC. There are, as we said, is that the there's a fix to Hartford's problems could you know most likely be a legislative fix. In addition, the MDC's charter could have some fixes that would be able to help us, such as we don't have working capital borrowing. In the event that the MDC's charter gets fixed and gives us this power, we could sit here and finance this shortfall over a longer period of time, and with those proceeds, we could refund the reserve payments. If everything worked well, we would hope we would never have to collect the reserve payment from any of the member towns, meaning either that City of Hartford has made all four of its payments, the state legislature comes up with a fix that fixes Hartford's issues, or possibly amends the MDC's charter that gives us some other powers that would allow us to not charge the reserve and find another way to finance this.
So can we wait to pay the reserve until all those things happen?
Well, that's what the reserve is scheduled for, October of 2017, so it gives us time for the legislative session to start and take action from January up until that point.
But we would have to budget for that in our budget this year.
Each of the member towns' charters a little bit differently, but my understanding is that Wethersfield would have to budget it in their fiscal 18 budget.
And if we choose not to pay it?
Not to pay the reserve?
Yeah. What if we don't participate?
That would be a legal question.
I'm an accountant. I'll let the lawyer answer that one.
Well, my name's Chris Stone. I work for the NDC. I'm one of their district councils. And we have certain options available to us under our charter to collect either unpaid ad valorem payments or insufficiently paid ad valorem payments. And in fact, we plan to use some of those collection mechanisms if the City of Hartford doesn't pay. For example, while it may take some court intervention, we have the right to tax the inhabitants of the city that or the town that doesn't pay. Either jointly or severally. So we could seek payment by execution against one or more businesses in the City of Hartford, or if Wethersfield doesn't pay, one or more businesses within the town of Wethersfield. It's a very draconian collection effort. It hurts, and we choose, quite frankly, we would hope that it never gets to that point. But it is available to us, and also these are tax warrants, so we could also apply for an execution against the assets of either the City of Hartford or another member town. Again, another draconian collection tool that's available to us. We hope not to have to pursue that remedy. Not only are those remedies difficult or harsh on the payor, the town, but they also may take some time. And we deal in real time, in real budgets. We have operating expenses that we have to pay. And waiting a year or a year and a half for legal proceedings to resolve themselves on these collection efforts is also not very enticing. It's not a viable option. This was the option that was least intrusive. We would hope, quite frankly, as John pointed out, we're very hopeful that the City of Hartford will make their January and April payments, and we're optimistic that the City of Hartford will make their July and October payments as well. We have to plan almost worst case scenario. And we haven't even discussed, and I don't expect John to discuss it, and quite frankly, the other doomsday scenario, and that is that Hartford files bankruptcy, or is allowed to file bankruptcy. Mm-hmm. There's been some suggestion that member towns compel or bring Hartford into bankruptcy. to have an overseer or trustee to oversee their operations. That's not available to us or to any of the member towns. Hartford has to, if they choose bankruptcy as an option, and by the way, we have no official statement from the city of Hartford that that's an option that they're pursuing, just to make it clear. It's been in the press, but that doesn't make it real. If the city of Hartford were to ultimately choose that option, they have to get permission from the governor's office to do so. We cannot put them into bankruptcy under title the chapter that they would be filing under. It's not an available option. So this addresses the bankruptcy filing somewhat in having this reserve available. But quite frankly, there's so many unknowns in a municipality filing for bankruptcy that we cannot guard against all the possibilities that would be forthcoming from such a filing. We have spoken with the mayor. Your mayor, your town manager have been in meetings with the mayor, and quite up to this point, bankruptcy is not an option for the city of Hartford, but it's been talked about. So we have to obviously deal with that.
As a follow-up,
sure.
Back to your charter, does it mention a reserve? I understand the tax implication, but is the reserve even in there?
Well, the word isn't used, but what it does say is that we have to plan our budget, our ad valorem budget, to make sure that we can meet all the expenses on the sewer side of our business. And if we're under any indication that one or more of our member towns are not able to pay what would otherwise be their ad valorem tax, then we have to find some other revenue source to meet our operating expenses. Again, we're real time. We can do some short-term borrowing, but there are things that we can do and have offered, or we've planned to offer to the General Assembly to allow us to do. We've submitted to our board a list of three items that we would go to the General Assembly to try to get some more flexibility than we have. But the bottom line is we have to meet those the operating expenses on our sewer side, and that's where we developed this reserve. Is it specifically referenced? No, quite frankly. But we have to meet our operating budget. And if one or more of our member towns is giving an indication that, and this is, by the way, this goes back to before the mayor made a commitment to make the January and April payment. Originally, there was a greater reserve than what you have in front of you. But we have an indication that it will be difficult. And he said that the financial officer for the city said it in a meeting, a budget workshop. It may be difficult for them to meet their July and October payment. We have to plan accordingly.
So is this going to be a one-time fix? Because what if that's the continuum over the next several years?
Counselor, you've hit on really what is the long-term problem here, and which is why the legislature has to, and I don't know what the answer is. We've talked about increasing the pilot payments from the state to the city for their exempt property. We've talked about, or they've talked about, other revenue sources for the city and increasing the sales tax that goes to the city. I don't know what the answer is, but it is a long-term, potentially long-term issue or problem that requires fundamental changes in the way that cities, and in particular the city of Hartford, raises revenue. I don't know what the answer is, but you hit on it, that it could go beyond our fiscal 2017.
And so when you guys are putting your budget together at MDC, what are you doing to sort of cut your costs to offset some of the reserve you're asking from everybody else?
I'll let John handle some specifics. I'll just tell you generally, we've gone from over 700 employees in the past 5 years down to 510. We plan on going down to 485. We've done some creative things John will get into in financing and trying to save some money on the financing side. We're doing more with less. We're relying heavily on technology to cut our costs. We've got some incentives, with very modest incentives, to try to reduce our employee pool where we have real savings in real time. So we're trying to cut our costs. John has worked on our budget ad nauseum to try to find not just where revenue sources, but where we can cut. And John, why don't you talk a little bit about what you guys have been doing?
As a follow-on to what Councillor Stone had said, is that in the difference from the 2016 budget and the 2017, there's been 35 positions that have been fully defunded and eliminated. that's just not just by cutting people. That was a planned effort in through going through the compensation classification study, redesigning, redoing the job descriptions to expand, to have multitasking through there. So through the good work and through the bargaining aspect, we were able to do that. In addition, the exempt and excluded employees are foregoing any COLA in the 2017 budget. The only COLAs that are factored in are the ones that are supported in the collective bargaining units. So about, probably 100 people are exempt, and the remaining 400 are collective bargaining unit folks. In addition, just to kind of put it in a little bit of perspective, the sewer operating expenses, payroll and payroll related, is 40% of the operating expenses. Debt service, because we're a very capital intensive operation, we have over $1.2 billion in assets in the sewer. That's net assets, net capital assets. Debt service is 33% of the operating expenses. Utilities are another 6 to 7%. Payments to the state DEEP for nitrogen credits associated with the water pollution control facility is another 2%. So when you add that up, we're well over 80%. So there's not a lot of other things that can cut, but we've gone through, and as humanly possible, as Council Attorney Stone had said, we're down from 700 people down to below 500 bodies, and it's being achieved through technology as well as competing everything and trying to get the best price on any kind of commodity that we have. One of the biggest savings that has come to help support keep this down is the heat generation facility down in the South Meadows. We're producing approximately 30% of the electricity to run the South Meadows water pollution control facility. So things such as that was a capital investment with grant money from the feds through a CREB program that has been put in place. It's planning like that for long term to try to save money. So that we think we've picked up all the quick one-time savings, and we have some of the longer term strategic decisions that are helping save us money now.
Mike? What's the MDC's fund balance right now?
General fund balance? The general fund unrestricted fund balance is $14.5 million.
I'm just a believer that Wethersfield taxpayers paying, Hartford's MDC bill is bailing out Hartford and paying for their failed policies and probably paying for a new baseball stadium in Hartford. They're going to pay those bills before they pay their water bill. That doesn't seem right. So I, for one, I'm going to fight this, and I think you should go after Hartford's assets, and I hope our commissioners would vote against it.
Other questions for John?
Oh. I was just going to say a processy question. When do you need to have an answer by? When do your commissioners meet next to vote?
The as I mentioned before, we were going out for a negotiated GO bond sale, and some of the feedback, obviously it's a tough market, some of the feedback we received from the underwriters as well as the folks in the trading desk, they asked us before pricing to actually have the board meeting to consider the 2017 budget. So tomorrow at 12 noon, the NBC District Board is meeting to discuss and vote on the 2017 budget with the ad valorem, with the reserve. And then based upon that, then we'll move forward with, what are options with the sale of the GO bonds.
Tony?
John, what is your proposed 2017 budget right now?
For?
That you're proposing for the
water and
coming
sewer, or just sewer?
In total?
41 million or something.
And if you want to break out water and sewer too,
sure.
That's fine.
That's fine. The water budget is $83.5 million. And, I got to do some math. It's sewer would be, I got the old budget book, so I'll take off. It's about $76 million for the sewer side.
And the loss from Hartford, did I hear you right? That's like about $5.1 million.
Currently, if
they don't make those two payments.
If they don't make those two payments, the sum of those two payments, they're $2,937,875, so it's called just a hair under $6 million, those two payments.
Okay. Is there any way the budget you're proposing could be cut any to reduce this amount?
Like I said,
by doing some cost analysis?
Yeah, I mean,
I know you're under a timeline, but I mean, when the Board of Ed comes to us and they're, you know, they give us an X amount of dollars and we look at things and we determine what we can take in for revenue and we go back and reduce them, they find out how to adjust. Are there adjustments you can make for all of this or part of this?
I mean, as we have started this process with the towns on September 26th, and the number, as Jeff can attest, was a lot higher. We've basically, to get down to this point, we've got some pretty aggressive budgetary assumptions. One of them I'll just highlight on the sewer side, which is impacting the ad valorem. We have a pretty aggressive savings of $673,000 for refunding the MDC's 2010 general obligation bond issue. Now, given what the market's been doing since the election in November 8th, it's almost been moving about 5 basis points a day. Plus, if you listen to the Fed's proposing a rate hike in December. So that $673,000 savings is within a window of a plus 50 basis points. Pretty much that's evaporating. So that's the kind of aggressive assumptions we have in the 2017 budget. We've eliminated, as I said before, 35 positions. Of the 19 vacancies, we're only funding them for a quarter of the year. So we felt that between that and debt service is 73% of our budget. We've taken pretty much almost everything that we can there.
I have another question.
Yeah, go ahead, Mike Curley.
Oh, sorry, Mike.
No.
Since our budget goes a year, would that mean that we would have to budget $1.4 million? Because our budget goes out, too, and we only get one time to budget.
So your budget is your fiscal 18 budget. The way that the MDC does the ad valorem payments, the January and April payments are no more than 25% each of the prior years adopted. So there's never any increase in the January, April. It's predicated based upon what we have given you. So, you know, I think the other councilor had said is that this ad valorem reserve and credit model is kind of a 12-month closed loop. So it doesn't spill over beyond the MDC's 12-month period. We would hope that there's a legislative fix either for the city of Hartford or some other powers that the district might have to not do this again in our fiscal 18.
Mike Rowe.
Thanks, John. With everything that's going on up in Hartford, you know, I think their focus right now is probably going to be the $1.5 billion deficit facing the state of Connecticut. You know, I know Hartford has a pretty strong lobby up there. The legislators are pushing the majority party to get a fix as soon as possible. Would MDC want a seat at the table in negotiations? You know, kind of piggybacking off of what Mike said, they've got payments for the baseball field coming up. They've got incurred costs, you know, all over the place. Would MDC want to sit there and, you know, start negotiating and making sure that with what's being paid out by the city of Hartford, that MDC is at the top of the list?
Well, I mean, from a legislative standpoint, as we said in the various meetings with the member towns leadership, you know, the MDC would like to partner with the member towns to develop a legislative agenda, and I defer to Chris Stone on that one.
Council, I think the MDC will be at the table, and for two reasons, or two purposes. One is to make sure that our interest in getting paid by the city of Hartford is perfected, that we push it. Secondly, and that there's some resolution, because again, as Councilor Latina pointed out, we don't want this spilling over into 2018 and 19. There's got to be a fundamental fix from the state capitol to assist not just the city of Hartford, but selfishly for us, the city of Hartford and their problems, its problems. So that's one priority. The other priority is there are things that the legislature can do that's not going to cost them any money. There's things that they can do with our charter. We've proposed three things, there may be more, but we've proposed three things, three legislative fixes that we want all our member towns to be supportive of that won't cost the taxpayers of the state any more money, doesn't mean a huge revenue spend by the at the Capitol, but changes to our charter that gives us more flexibility to deal with this issue than our charter presently provides. Quite frankly, when the MDC was formed in 1929, the last thing on their mind was having one of our member towns not be able to pay the sewer ad valorem bill. And this is the first time that we have experienced that situation. First time. It's never happened before. This is unprecedented. So providing more flexibility in our charter at no cost to the taxpayer, I think, is also a priority that the MDC is going to pursue. Obviously, we have our legislative committees within the MDC that have to give us their approvals to move forward, and the district board has to give us the direction to move forward. But assuming that that's the case, we would ask all municipalities within the MDC, including the city of Hartford, quite frankly, to join us in trying to get those legislative changes. The city, the options for the city, and Councilor Rell, you know what goes on up there. Everyone's going to be fighting over money. And the state budget, 1.5, is probably a modest estimate, quite frankly, at least going into fiscal year 2018, as to where the state of Connecticut is. We're not going to let our MDC management and the MDC board is not going to just kick this down the road to put ourselves in a position that arguably Hartford has put itself in and keep moving the problem down the road. It's a tough pill to swallow. We get it. But delaying it or pretending that it doesn't exist or borrowing our way out of it is not a solution. There's really got to be some fundamental changes for the city and potentially fundamental changes to our charter to give us more flexibility to address this issue. It really hasn't come up before. It's the first time.
Chris, I wish you were still in the legislature. I mean, you could fix the
problems
going on.
What are the charter changes that you're
great
proposing?
Point. Thank you, Councilor. There's three that we've proposed. First of all, I will tell you selfishly, and I do some of the work with it, for the MDC up at the Capitol. Anytime you open up a charter, you open up for anything. So we have to be careful. And you can't ask for a whole laundry list of changes because you may end up getting nothing. It'll die of its own weight. So we're asking for a couple things. To extend our ability or term of our tax anticipation notes from 6 months. We've asked for 3 years. I think 2 years may be where it might work, but we've asked for three. We're going to ask for three. We've asked for the ability to do mid-year corrections to our budget. Right now, as John pointed out, we don't have the flexibility to do that. If we had that flexibility, then perhaps instead of dealing with the issue now, we'd be able to do a midterm correction if Hartford doesn't pay, and then pass on that obligation, at least in part, to our towns or do other things that would we'd be able to correct as we go. Right now, we don't have that flexibility. We have it on the expense side. If we have to spend money in an emergency, we have that flexibility upon a vote by the board. We don't have it on the revenue side. I've drafted the language already, and it would work. It would give us an additional tool. The other thing is relates to the bankruptcy side, is to allowing us to treat our ad valorem levy as a tax levy with the same priority as the collection of taxes. Obviously, it would be a second line to the United States government and to whatever taxes the state may be owed, if any. But give us the priority that a tax levy would have and a lien would have to collect. So those three things, and it's not we don't consider those to be a huge ask of the legislature, but being a special chartered municipality, they have to act. We can't give those powers to ourselves. The legislature has to do that. So those are three things, and by the way, it's not a finite list. So if there's any recommendations, and by the way, two of the recommendations that I just talked about came from member towns. So it's a constant dialogue. I would just caution you that, you know, a list of 10 items is probably not gonna work. So, but Councilor Rell knows this all too well. A modest request that doesn't cost the taxpayer any money, but gives us those flexible tools, it could work.
Yeah. Anna?
Just a couple questions. Have you considered changing your fiscal year in your request to the legislature? Because I know that's mapped out in the charter.
It is.
To be more in line with the member towns' fiscal years, to make your planning more in sync with what the other communities are doing? That's just one. And then are you looking at potential revamping of what the ad valorem contains and how that is affixed and apportioned within a community? So, you know, what does it include? Could it include more? Should it include more? So that you're spreading it out so it's a more equalized type of formula.
Well, I'll answer the last question first, then I'll let John answer the first one. We were asked, quite frankly, to consider modifying, and it may be brought up by the city of Hartford, but there was a question as to how exempt property was treated for purposes of determining what the ad valorem charge would be. And what Hartford proposed was that each town should get the credit for their non-taxable exempt property directly. And once that town got their credit, then they would have their ad valorem payment. The problem with that scenario is, number one, and most significantly, it's contrary to our charter provides. Our charter provides that we arrive at the whole budget, we subtract from the budget monies received from non-exempt properties district-wide, and then the net is divided up according to the tax formula that John pointed out, the average three-year tax collection apportioned amongst the eight member towns. If we did it the way the city of Hartford had suggested, their ad valorem would go down, and more likely than not, and I don't know how much tax-exempt property you have in Wethersfield, quite frankly, but more likely than not, those towns that don't have a high exempt property sewer user fee coming in, their ad valorem would go up. So, and again, this our charter is stood the test of time, quite frankly. 1929, we've had very few amendments of our charter since then. But back then, the amount of tax-exempt property in the city of Hartford was probably much less than the 52-53% there is now. And that's why Hartford had suggested the change. I think it meant, I want to say, about $2 million lower ad valorem if we did it the way they wanted us to calculate it. So we're staying away from that because it hurts the other member towns, and it's not what our charter provides. The other option or discussion had been around adopting a sewer user fee instead of an ad valorem charge. Mm-hmm. The issue with that is that it's going to be a shift of responsibility for the sewer system to homeowners because they're the water users, and the sewer user charge would be based upon water consumption. The office buildings or the churches, the wherever, they're not the water consumers. The water consumers are residences. And we've stayed away from abandoning our ad valorem charge for that reason. The other reason why it may not be as cost effective as one thinks is because we don't have the infrastructure within the MDC, and you as a former commissioner know that we don't have the infrastructure to in a day convert from an ad valorem to a sewer user collection system. Thirdly, because our expense is part of a tax bill, a real estate tax bill, whatever is paid or whatever part of that real estate tax bill is paid by the homeowner or the property owner is tax exempt or tax deductible, excuse me, off their state and federal income taxes. So they receive that benefit. A sewer user fee would not be. And we did a study, Commissioner, I don't know if you were commissioner at the time, but we did a study, I think it was back in the late 90s, on what it meant to go from an ad valorem system that we have and a sewer user fee for individual ratepayers. And there was no benefit, in fact, a negative benefit to the average homeowner. And so we didn't go that route. John, you want to talk about the other?
Yeah, and the fiscal year offset, the MDC being on a calendar year versus a municipal calendar year, I think that provides the ability for the towns to see what's coming down the pipe. We're 6 months in advance. If we were going at the same time, we'd be having these discussions as you're advancing your budget through adoption. So it would be difficult to have that dialogue to make sure that both entities have the appropriate budgets, because if we're on the same path, same timeline, you'd be making a lot of assumptions about what we're about to warrant or what our tax levy is going to be, because you're not going to see it until you adopt. So I think that's the rationale for the different fiscal. In addition, you know, it also kind of provides the seasonal cycle. The water utility and so forth breaks and all are more significant in the front end of the year, higher consumptions in the middle of the year. So kind of almost the water utility consumption comes down at the end of the year. So it almost has like an operating cycle that fits more of a calendar year.
And just one last thing, if I may, just on Councilor Hurley had mentioned the baseball stadium. NDC provides a service, the sanitary sewer service, that we cannot cut off. People don't pay their water bills. We have the authority to shut off the water. We don't have the ability to eliminate, terminate sewer services to the residences and businesses of the city of Hartford. I say that in reference to the baseball. We consider ourselves a health priority, and payment of a health expense that deserves the priority, whether it's under present circumstances or a bankruptcy filing or state oversight, whatever it might be. We consider the providing sanitary sewer services to residences and businesses has a priority, period. And when we're sitting at that table, we'll make that clear. And if choices have to be made, they should be made on paying their ad valorem tax, not on paying for a baseball stadium. But that's my public policy statement for the night, not necessarily NDC's.
Okay, I just don't think that they will make the right choices. Hartford hasn't made a lot of right choices in a lot of years, so I think they'll make the poor choices again, and Wethersfield will be stuck with it.
How many water companies across the nation have this ad valorem tax?
I don't know. With the Clean Water Act, I believe back in the late 70s, early 80s, the EPA wanted sewer systems to move away from an ad valorem system to a sewer user charge. We were grandfathered in to where we were allowed to keep our ad valorem system with some modification. We have a kind of a hybrid. It's mostly ad valorem, but there's also exempt property and high-end user sewer fees that are more like a sewer user fee, well, they are a sewer user fee, and they get a credit off their ad valorem payment and their taxes. So the trade-off to keeping the ad valorem system was to have some form of sewer user fee for high volume users, exempt users, and users that have a high level of concentration of certain elements to what they discharge into the sanitary sewer system.
Who would be exempt?
Well, there's your churches, your hospitals, universities. They're, when I say exempt, they're not exempt from paying us, but because they're exempt from paying taxes, they don't contribute to the ad valorem charge. So state buildings, municipal buildings. So we capture the cost to provide them sewer services through this sewer user fee.
That's one of the revenues that, as Attorney Stone had said, is when we set the sewer budget for operating expenses by our charter, you deduct the revenue from, you know, sludge, septage, and then the revenue that's called our sewer user charge for the, you know, the tax exempts, the high flow, and the concentration. And that comes up with the net expense that has to be funded by the ad valorem. So that's already taken into account. What Council's Attorney Stone was talking about was, see if Hartford wanted to expand or change the formula to get credit for the tax exempt properties that were paying the sewer user charge to the MDC. So that would reduce their ad valorem payment.
So I'm not quite sure I understand all of that, but would there ever be a thought process in having some of these people come online and therefore pay so that it would lower it for the whole entire group?
Well, the ad valorem tax is a tax to the member municipalities, which is considered an operating expense, and then it's put into the mill rate of each of the individual towns. What we're talking about is, you know, Hartford Hospital, St. Francis, Trinity College, they're not paying property taxes to the city of Hartford. So what we do is, based upon their water bill, their consumption, on their water bill, they'll pay for the base water rate, with, you know, $2.66. They'll pay for the meter quarterly charge. They'll have the special sewer service charge or the clean water project based on consumption.
and they'll have a sewer user charge of $2.86 per CCF to pay for their piece or their use of the sewer system.
They are online.
So they are paying.
They are online. The bottom line is okay. They are paid, just in a different form, not through their taxes, because they don't pay taxes.
Got it.
They're paying another way.
Thank you.
Mike Rowe?
Not to belabor this, but the Niagara bottling plant, when are we looking at, or when are you guys looking at completion date? And
I believe I don't think they're online now, but I know they're close, if maybe December, January of 17. December 16, January
About 17.
About a year. This year.
End of this year.
The end of this year. This either December 2016 or January 17.
Oh, really? I thought it was longer than that.
I don't think it's a very complicated structure, quite frankly. It's a steel frame building, and it went up very fast because they came in, I think it was April, and they're close to being complete.
They're going to water consumption. They're going to be paying fees to
Correct.
MDC. I mean,
Correct.
What are you guys looking at for revenue from Niagara?
John can answer that question, but just be careful or cautious. We have two sides of the house, our water side and our sewer side. Any revenues that we receive on the water side can offset some general expenses, overall expenses, because water contributes to our overall expenses, administration, et cetera. But for the most part, we keep those two revenue sources separate so that, for example, we don't use any of the ad valorem fees to pay for our sewer, our water side of the business.
Yeah.
And we can't do it the other way. The state statute provides and our charter provides that we're to charge for water the reasonable cost of providing water, creating the supply, maintaining the supply, treating the water, and distribution of the water to our customers. That's on the water side. And it has to be our water charges and revenues have to relate to those functions. So we can't cross the revenue stream. So if you want to answer the question, John.
At the 2016 adopted rate structure, assuming they built out all that they said they would, which is around 800,000 CCF a year, it would be on the water, as Attorney Stone said, be about $2 million in water utility revenue on the proprietary fund. And then because of their consumption is greater than 12,000 CCF, they would be subject to a high flow sewer user charge. So that might be roughly maybe about $100,000 of incremental sewer revenue. And then they would be paying the special sewer service charge, which is a dedicated revenue that goes into the Clean Water Project Fund and goes into a separate escrow. And those funds can only be used for the payment of either capital expenditures associated with projects to meet the consent order and consent decree, or the debt service of funding for those projects that are used to meet the consent order and consent decree milestones.
Are you, in tomorrow's budget vote, are you anticipating the $2 million revenue from Niagara on the water?
The water utility consumption assumption is 20 million CCFs. Since the last 10 years, it's about 20% down on consumption. We had a high of about 25 million CCFs back in 2005. And it's been steadily going down on a consistent basis each year. I mean, technology and household appliances, technology advancements in manufacturing processes, reduction of manufacturing facilities.
The call from the governor for, you know, moderate water use during drought.
Could be now, but the longer path, we haven't had droughts to this severity since the 1960s. So it's more or less it's water efficient washers, dryers, dishwashers, and the manufacturing process is, you know, reclaiming water, better HVAC systems that capture and reduce the condensation loss. Those things have probably contributed, plus the number of businesses that are not here.
Thank you, guys.
Other questions?
Well,
Chris,
John,
thank you for being
here.
I know it's an unfolding story we're going to continue to work on. So
you and the town manager have been very cooperative with us, and at times, and other times you've disagreed with us, but you've certainly been a very strong voice at the meetings we've had with our member towns. And whether we agree or disagree, your participation is very much appreciated. So thank you,
Chris. John, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Bill, thanks. We're going to move into public comment. David?
Good evening. David Krug, 149 Upper Ross Street. I'm talking about MDC today. I hope they stay and listen to the public. There's been a lot of issues going on with MDC, and I watched the state meetings online on CT Network, where a lot of people from Windsor were upset with them because they didn't tell anybody that they're going to ask the towns, I don't know if it's ask or demand, but they're going to ask the town to fill the bill for, it was $11 million in the current, but I hear maybe it may be less now, but I don't know if Hartford said they're going to pay a certain amount, because I could barely hear him. He was a little bit kind of soft. But this is an issue that I'm glad Jody mentioned. What if we don't pay? You know, what if we don't pay? What are they going to do? And I heard from one of the representatives say that, well, they can't turn off the water. It's a health issue. Well, I guess they can't turn off our water either if we don't pay the difference that Hartford can't pay. They're not going to turn off Hartford's water, and they're paying. They may not be able to pay anything, and they'll leave their water on. But they expect all the surrounding towns, all seven surrounding towns, West Hartford, over $2 million. It may be less. I couldn't hear what he said. But and then Niagara Water, they're paying less than water. Are they paying any bit of this $11 million? You know, he said, well, the streams are different. The water they use in the sewer, well, I guess Niagara doesn't have any sewers. I guess maybe they just put all their excess water in a big bathtub. You know, all businesses have sewers. They use a big sewer, and they're using a lot of water. How much money are they contributing to this possible loss of revenue for MDC? You know, I feel bad for MDC because it shouldn't be like this. You know, this is the first time I can remember that Hartford has not been able to pay their bills, but Hartford is a mess. Their city is run poorly, and I'm thinking can they legally take our money? You know, I don't know. And we never brought that out. When I read in the paper, it said that they were asking the surrounding towns to pay the foot to bill for Hartford. But are they asking, or can they legally just say, hey, you have to pay the bill? I don't think we should have to pay the bill. I think, you know, the state should have some kind of responsibility in helping out Hartford. Hartford is the capital of our state. If Hartford can't pay its bill, maybe the state should foot the bill. Not the surrounding towns. If you go in a line at a grocery store and the guy in front of you says, "Oh, I don't have any money. I can't pay," cashier say, "Oh, that's all right. I'll charge the guy behind you for the balance," and can he do that? No. Can the NDC do that? I'm not so sure. I don't know if he can. They can. You know, I don't know if there's anything in writing say that if Hartford can't pay, the surrounding towns have to pay. You know, it's not right. And one more point. You guys have been talking about regionalism. Now, regionalism is shared services. We're not talking about water here. But if Hartford can't pay its bill, why would we want to share services with Hartford, and maybe we'll end up paying the bill for 100% of the bill for what they can't pay? You know, Hartford is in a mess. It's not the time to do shared services with a town that can't pay its own bills. Thanks.
Thanks, David. Who else wishing to speak this evening? Matt? Do you want to defer to Tom? Or you want to come up, Matt?
Hi, good evening and happy Thanksgiving, everyone. Matt D'Angelo of 16 Denison Ridge, recovering politician. I want to go back. The election's over, and I had kind of predicted, I think we all did, that things would calm down when the election was over, and it doesn't seem to necessarily be the case, in, at least in parts of our country. And I don't want to relitigate what was said or not said, and frankly, given the makeup of some of our friends in the audience, I'm not going to get into the weeds. I do want to advise and extend some remarks I made in the newspaper. And I want people to understand it wasn't about Trump versus Clinton. It wasn't about Warren versus Hurley or Democrat versus Republican. I had said, Mr. Mayor, in regard to your post, that I had no problem with basically 99% of what you wrote and said. Thought it was fair game in politics. I did take issue with one phrase, and I do honestly feel that it was a phrase which merited an apology. Now, I know you, I like you. I had the sense from reading between the lines in some of your later comments that you probably, at some level, regretted including the inclusion of that one phrase. And my criticism of it is more of a personal and social nature in that you're talking about a guy that you've served with for 7 years. He's, you sit at the same table with him. I mean, I myself have had some differences with him over the years, but like you, he grew up in this town. Our kids, we go to the same church. Our kids got confirmed together. They graduated high school together. His son and the deputy mayor's son were teammates on the soccer team. And I felt that that one line was something that he really didn't deserve. You know, you can criticize him all you want over his choice of who he voted for. You can criticize him all you want over his stand on the issues. But that was a line that I really did think on a personal level went a little too far, and I felt that an apology would have been in order. I think it's still in order, frankly, because the election's over. We've got to move forward with the task of living together and working together. And again, my respect for our sensitivity of the people in the audience is such a, I'm not going to go into the weeds about what was said or what was not said. I just want to discharge what, you know, where I'm coming from on that and wish everybody the best. Thank you.
Thanks, Matt. Tom?
Good evening. Tom Mazzarella, 600 Walcott Hill Road. Just want to comment about MDC. I don't want to go over everything that's been discussed tonight. We've got a lot of good information. My personal feeling is along the lines of what Mike and Jody stated. I don't believe Wethersfield should be involved in Hartford's financial problems. Wethersfield's budget and finances is in a way very similar to Hartford. We have a lot of property here that's not taxed. We spend more than we take in on all sorts of things. Maybe some of the purchases aren't so smart, although we don't have a ball field to pay for. But I don't think that Wethersfield should have to reinvent their budget and come up with $1.2 million or 700, whatever the number is, and reserve that in the event that Hartford can't make their payment. One of the speakers tonight, I think it was Chris, I'm not sure of the name, he used the term draconian as in response to, what if we don't pay the bill? What if we decide not to contribute to the reserve? And they have to use draconian measures to go after the payments from Hartford residents, or maybe Wethersfield. I don't know how it would work. And he further described it as less intrusive. Going along with the method they're proposing. Well, less intrusive just means easier for them. It's a lot easier to just send one bill out to Wethersfield for $1.2 million than to go after every water user in the city of Hartford. It's Hartford's problem. They can either raise their taxes and get more money or spend less money on all this other nonsense. MDC doesn't want to put themselves in the same position as Hartford. They don't want to come up short. But it's okay for us to come up short. Where are we going to get another $1.2 million or $1.4 million? You're going to come after the taxpayers. The Wethersfield taxpayers are going to end up paying for Hartford's water. That's just not right. The other part that really gets under my skin is the fact that they had a public meeting last week. I wasn't at the meeting, but it was reported in the newspaper that they decided, well, they'll back off on this plan because there was so much backlash. Then I go away for the weekend, and I come back, and I read Saturday's paper. Oh, guess what? We changed our mind. We're going back to Plan A, and we're going to have an emergency meeting to vote on it on Tuesday. So they didn't come here tonight to ask you what your opinion was or which way you wanted to vote. They came here to tell you what was going to happen. Tuesday, they're going to vote. The thing's going to get approved, and you guys are going to get a bill for $1.2 million, or whatever the number is reduced to. And I don't think that's right. So I would hope that our representation, our commissioners or whatever that we have on MDC's board, would vote against this plan. There was an article in The Current that interviewed several of the town member towns. I didn't see any comment in there from Wethersfield. What is Wethersfield's position? Do we support this reserve fund? I would like to know. And if you could tell us tonight, I think it would be appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Yes, in the back.
Sorry, short strides. Took me a second to get up here. Ray Townsend, I'm resident on the Broad Street Green. And I guess I'm a little surprised at the MDC's response that they're just now looking at needing a reserve to cover potential shortfalls from customers. I would have expected that there would have been some place in their budget, whether overrunning or underrunning over year, to have a place to build in a reserve for just something like this. The concept of a municipality going under is not new. We've had a number of them declare bankruptcy, most notably Detroit. So this shouldn't have come as a surprise as they're stating it was. This may be the first time it's happened, but what I'm really interested in knowing is what they're going to do now, going forward, to prevent this situation from happening again, to where they need to go out to other customers and request further funding. That's point one. And then point two, I would urge the town of Wethersfield to take all actions to reject the additional charges, including court action if it's appropriate and available, to prevent the seizure of state or city property. So, thank you.
Great. Before you get down, what was your last name again?
Townsend. T-O-W-N-S-E-N-D.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other public comment? Okay. Seeing none, we'll move into, while the MDC is here, I do want to, I'm going to just go a little out of order with a comment about adding to the narrative of what has occurred over the last couple of months in September, along with Jeff Bridges and the towns that have attended the meetings with the MDC. To your point, Tom, so you know what we have said and what we've communicated. You know, I think it's important that MDC was here to talk about the latest numbers. Of course, the number has changed since the commitment from Hartford to pay the first two quarters has reduced the exposure to the question that came out of the bond council advice to the MDC. I wouldn't even call it advice, frankly. I think it was basically a warning to the MDC about the need to have that fund available or risk a sizable impact on the cost of their bonding for the remainder portion that they're about to refinance. And as we have had these discussions with the MDC and the mayors from member towns have been attending, along with town managers and the finance managers from those towns, there has been obviously a strong expression of opposition to the fact that the cost would be passed on to the towns. I think it was a surprise initially to the towns and the mayors that in the event of a shortfall from Hartford, that the charter of the MDC had a provision like this that would pass back. And so the initial education to us was part of it. But obviously, the mayor from Hartford attended and indicated a commitment to pay the first two quarters, which reduced the exposure and the amount of money involved. But again, we have expressed not only an understanding of the MDC's issue, but I'll point out that one of the things that was evident, and this is still very much in flux, but and has led to another point, which I'll make in a second. We communicated to them that there has to be quite a bit more participation on the part of the state legislature as a result. Clearly, the solution to this with Hartford lies in resources that go beyond the local municipality, that the solution needs to be grappled with in special session. And we've obviously been communicating, I think all the member towns have been talking with their elected delegation at the state level, expressing, and we're hearing Wethersfield, one example, I'm obviously most familiar with that, but I'm also hearing from the other mayors at these meetings about a wave of reaction from residents, very upset about the concept. And in its starkest form, it suggests that the bill for Hartford will be passed back to these other municipalities with no recourse, and that it's simply going to be paid and, you know, we'll have a fight on our hands or something of that nature. It's clearly more complicated than that, and there are provisions for payback when and if Hartford's problems get resolved. So we're participating at the table. I think the one of the important points is that the mayors understand that are sitting at the table that if the bond impact on MDC were to be negative to MDC, that eventually trickles back to us as well. So MDC, in some sense, I want to be careful and to say they're not on the opposite side of the table fighting with the towns. They're saying, look, we have a problem that we're facing with our sewage coverage under the ad valorem. Hartford has problems and is exposed. If we become exposed because the bonds are being sold at a higher rate, that cost is going to go back somewhere. We're going to find it in our water bills, or we're going to find it in some other things. So the fact that the MDC is responding responsibly to solve that so that they answer the bond issue to keep that cost down, because that's not a recaptured cost. Once that bond issue gets sent out, if the rating continues to drop and they don't provide an answer to this very troubling question, you're not going to get that interest back. You know, 3 years from now, you're going to be paying that for the extended period of the bond. So we're actually partners with the MDC on that part of the problem, even though we might have great resistance to the municipalities being tagged with it. So I want to be sure that to your point, Tom, and hopefully to the public and to our full council, we are obviously expressing, you know, very assertively, town managers are expressing very assertively that this creates a great issue for us. And of course, we have to make decisions by May 15th in Wethersfield, which will be in advance of when some of this resolution may present itself. But again, the delegation is saying at the state level, we know this has to get addressed. And whether it gets addressed in the context of all the other things that are happening with the state is anybody's guess. But we are aggressively communicating, participating, and the MDC has reached out to the mayors at least six times on this that we have sat in meetings. So it is not resolved, it is not answered. And frankly, how we would respond to it if this ad valorem hit trickles its way into our budgets is something that the full council is going to have dialogue along with every other line item. So, you know, I would tell you, I think you know, the chairman of the MDC is here. He knows our position. You know, we've asked him to come and explain at least today's scenario with it. And we obviously, and I think I said this publicly when this story first broke, our first priority, of course, is to our taxpayers. And we're going to do everything we can to reach out to our state delegation to say this problem needs to be at the state level, not trickling into these other member towns. That's simply taking a very big problem and trickling it into a very small funnel, which has significant impact. Whether it's $1.4 million or it's $700 or $659 at the end of the day on the first indications. We also said, and I spoke with the mayor of Hartford about this, even though their financial circumstances are such that payments on several things might be at risk, seems to me water and sewer should be in front of several other things, of course, and that's a decision they've got to make. But it's not a full non-payment either if they continue to have problems. So there are variations within this that are not so absolute, even though obviously the MDC has to have the worst case scenario covered and planned in response to the pressing issue, which is their bond issuance, which is coming up very rapidly. So all of that being said, obviously our councils want to weigh in, our residents are weighing in through emails and commentary and calling and expressing these concerns. And certainly I think it's important to remember we're in this together with MDC as one of our partners in a service that's very important to us, and the solutions are more complex than we're probably seeing and hearing tonight, but time is pressing them to make something as a reserve. So we're quite a ways away from having all of that hammered out, but I just want to share at least a broad sense, and I know our counselors will weigh in over the next few months. Hopefully we'll get some progress and Hartford's situation will be more clear. So I want to share that. I'm sure if we have some other questions later, I'll be glad to share anything else that we're working on. So hope that answered some of what you asked, Tom. Okay, we'll go back to council reports. Council reports? Or if anybody wants to comment on that, that's fine. You can comment on that, Jody, that's fine.
I just wanted to know, what is our position?
Well, our position is we want to avoid this scenario at all costs. It's not something we want to see happen because that's a huge hit in our budget. We're not ready to say yes to it, obviously, because we hope we're going to have some other information. But my energy in terms of where we are is to plead to our delegation that this problem has to get solved. And we can't wait till May for us to be stuck with it under a reserve. We've talked, Jeff and I have talked about some scenarios along with the other town managers about, I do not believe it should be a tax issue. It might be something where we're putting some safety nets in late in the year through our rainy day fund, our reserve, our fund balance or something, so we're not raising taxes. I would certainly think this council would be very reticent about saying we're going to respond to this number, whatever it is, by raising taxes. Mm-hmm. I think we're going to have to say that's absolutely off the table at the local level. And the MDC is not concerned about how we get there, but as long as we identify the reserve. But as you know, our fund balance, I believe, is north of 12%. We're required to keep it between 8 and 10 for our good bond rating. So it could be an encumbrance that we identify through that, and hopefully we'll have answers before we have to do that. But certainly don't envision this group would ever support, well, we're going to raise our mill rate to cover this 700 or 650. I don't see that happening. But that doesn't mean we won't participate in the worst case scenario if that happens. But we have some tools available to us that will certainly not impact our taxpayers. And I think this is a problem that's immediate. It may be 2 years of this problem, not only at the Hartford level, but the state level, as we all know, as Mike Rowe pointed out. So we're all kind of riding in this storm together. Eventually, hopefully, we hope it will clear. But that's why we have reserves. That's why we have municipalities weighing in on solutions like this. So I think that's a long answer, but obviously we're not ready to roll over and just say, okay, yeah, let's write the bill. I mean, I'm talking to Fonfara and Doyle and Guerrera and Russ and saying, hey, you guys got to roll up your sleeves and get to this.
Who are our MDC commissioners?
I think in Wethersfield, it's Mark Papa, Andy Addle, Dan Camilleri.
And
they certainly are very much.
Marty Cornyn,
correct. Thank you.
And so these folks have to vote at this noon meeting tomorrow?
I would assume that's the case, that they'll be attending and hearing this.
So we should somehow get word to them that we're not
every counselor is welcome to weigh in on their thoughts on that with their representation. That's why they're there. Absolutely. Mike?
So I know you stated a position, but my position would be we don't touch our fund balance either. That hurts our town, and we don't raise the mill rate. I mean, when the budget comes up, I would – in my position, I wouldn't vote for the budget with that in there.
Understood. Again, I think we're early. We're going at this with what are the other tools? What are the other resolutions?
And from my perspective, certainly it's premature to make a final decision about any of this. But I think in the interim, the legislative fix at the state level is where I think our energy is best served. And I think until we know what's happening there, we won't know what the decision is that we have to make and what's before us. So I think that's my position on it at this point, certainly. I do not favor the town of Wethersfield footing this bill. I think it is a statewide issue, and it's much larger than the local towns surrounding Wethersfield, surrounding Hartford.
I don't think that legislative fix is going to come until the latter part of the spring into the summer. So by then, our budget's already passed.
But we may have to make choices. Again, we've had to do that in the past as well, predicting what we think is going to happen, like we do with most of our budgets. We did the same thing last year.
It's just a big nut.
No, it's a tough decision, but and we're going to be faced with probably more tough decisions.
Okay, thank you. I want to make sure we got that before you guys have to take off, hear some of that out. Other council reports? Any council reports? Donna?
Just an update from the Housing Authority. Attended their meeting last week. They're moving along with their renovations to the elderly properties. They're being received well by the residents, and they're at the tail end of the Wethersfield Heights renovations with just some final punch list items and things to finish up. So they've made some really good progress. Their vacancy rate is low, which is always a positive thing.
Have you gone through it, Don? Have you seen it?
The actual renovation? I have not.
Yeah, I've been meaning to get over there. Thank you. Tony?
I attended the Senior Citizens Advisory Commission meeting last week, and one of the things for residents to be aware of is the home front applications. If anybody needs that is needy and needs some help in having repairs done to their houses, the application deadlines must be received by December 16th of this year to be considered for help in the 2017 year. In the past, that group has been able to repair roofs, windows, and do major repairs to houses to help some of the needy in town. So anybody that thinks they could use this service, contact Chris Taylor down in Social Services, and she'll help you fill out an application. But the deadline, once again, is around the corner, December 16th. And the Shared Services Committee had met. We got an update on the IT consolidation, which is going well. We asked the manager and superintendent to have a meeting with the maintenance department heads to meet together with them and the union leaders to attain information so we can look at the perspective of looking for consolidation of the town and board's maintenance down the road. So we're looking for information to work with to make that determination from those people. We want the unions included so that they're not coming in at the end saying we knew nothing about this or we have this problem. They'll be in the providing information stage right up front.
Tony, thank you. Mike Rell?
I attended the Historical Society meeting earlier this month, or no, end of October. And they do have a class that the high school students are participating in. The teacher had come in and said the class is actually full. They've run out of space. It's overwhelmingly popular. It's the Wethersfield Studies class. They go around a lot of the sites around Old Wethersfield and learn about Old Wethersfield and the history of Wethersfield. After tonight's meeting with looking at the Girl Scouts and then hearing from the MDC, I'm going to put in a recommendation that the high school students have to spend at least an hour here and listen to, you know, modern day government at work. But it was a really insightful presentation from the high school teacher about the class. The second thing is the Historical Society is putting on a show, an art show of Phil Lohman's work at the Keeney Center for the next couple months. Phil is a local resident here in Old Wethersfield, an artist, and his works have been in the Hartford Current, various national magazines, and a number of publications as well. So people have the time. They can come on down to the Keeney Center and take a look at Phil Lohman's work. He's a great asset to the town of Wethersfield.
Thank you, Mike. Any other council reports? Council comments? Any other council comments? Okay, Tony?
Last month I attended the 20th anniversary celebration for the Connecticut Health District in town. It was held at Timberland Golf Course. The guest speaker there was Senator Terry Giratana. She presented a proclamation to the state, and she brought everybody up on what the various health districts do and how they do it, and pending legislation. It was very, very informative. So I just want to congratulate the health district on her 20 years of combined service with the other towns.
Thank you, Tony. Mike?
Just December 1st, there's holidays on Maine. They block off the streets out in Old Wethersfield. It's a good time, 5 to 9. They have a bunch of food vendors. They have a craft, kind of a craft fair in the barn. There's a tree lighting. I think the mayor makes a few comments when the Santa Claus comes in, and it's a good event.
Thank you, Mike. Just a point of personal privilege, I was advised last night that Shirley Steinmetz, our Democratic town committee chair for many, many years, passed away last night. I don't know if you knew that, Rich. Maybe I'd heard about it. You know, those of you that knew Shirley, I'm sure many of you met her in the course of many years of contribution to this town in a lot of capacities. A first-class, wonderful human being who gave tirelessly to our community. So I ask for a moment of silence on her behalf. Thank you. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We're going to do, I'll do more
stuff. Yeah.
When he's here, yeah. When he's here next time.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it'd be more useful.
Yeah. Speaking of bonds, the town's going to go out in December for the last $8.8 million for the Wethersfield High School. We have a ratings call with S&P tomorrow to get the rating, and then we'll market the bonds before the end of December. There will be a meeting with the abutters of the Cloverdale Pond on Tuesday evening at 6:30 p.m. here in the council chamber with the engineering department. Invitation letters went out last week, so we want to meet with the abutters, go over the plans, make sure we get comments, cover the bases, and so we can do finalized plans and then get them bid out so we're in the position to construct that this summer. So that's a good thing. And you all heard about the MDC.
I sure did. Thank you, Jeff.
That's what I have.
And thank you for participating in those meetings. You've been a very important voice of the economics for Wethersfield and the concerns. So appreciate everything you've said. And I think you've been recognized for that because you've been consistently at all the meetings. So thank you.
I'm sure they're happy to see me.
Yes, they love you. As do I. Council action. I don't think we have any. I'm sorry, Dolores, anything? I'm sorry.
No, we had, the only thing is Red Lobster sold again last Friday for $7 million something. Santander sold, that property sold on the Celestine Highway. So we've been doing well with commercial property as well as higher priced homes in Wethersfield. So it's been looking better.
Thank you.
Nice.
Sorry for skipping.
What's going in place of the Red Lobster?
I'm sorry?
Is the Red Lobster changing over?
No, I think they just keep changing owners of the facility.
It's apparently an incredibly busy store. Which is,
I know, it's constantly
so,
busy.
You know, they do it for two or three years, sell it to somebody else who makes the money. So
a lot of money in shellfish.
A lot of money in lobster, I guess.
There isn't any lobster.
Red Lobster doesn't have any lobster? I don't go in there.
Only certain times of year.
Wow, that seems like a misnomer, doesn't it? Well, it just killed the sale, Dolores. Night going.
Cut off the microphones.
The new owner didn't know that.
Cash the convenience.
I'm sure he'll be shocked
first.
To learn. Yeah. Shrimp only. Okay. We do not. Do we have? Yes, we have one appointment. Tony.
For the Central Connecticut Health District, the appointment of John Aphorismo of 185 Broad Street. Effective 11/21/16 to 8/30/17.
I second that.
Motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. No resignations, no unfinished business. 3A.
Motion to approve the invoice for $30,000 for Quisenberry Arcari Architects for work related to the Wethersfield High School renovation.
Second.
We have a motion and second. Jeff? I know Sally's here.
Sally's here. Either this is the work to do the drawings for the natatorium, the swimming pool. That was on and above the original contract for the design of the high school, so that's an additional cost. It's been approved by the building committee.
Okay. Any questions about this for Sally or Jeff?
Paul?
Yes, Tony?
When I looked at the table on this whole thing with all the stuff for the architect, I see there's still $2,500 out there for the architect. For the track design, isn't that done and finished? Or should that be closed out, or is that a surplus amount?
We'll check on that.
Sure. Steve can take that back to the billing committee.
Right.
This was the number, was this the number of the 30,000 in the projection when they came? It was the correct number, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it was 25 to 30.
Yep. Okay. A lot of design work.
30
for a pool design.
Wow.
Well, and it wasn't just a pool, it was lights.
No, I know the lights and the bleachers and.
Well, what I'm saying is it wasn't even a pool.
Exactly.
Yeah, no, I know. I don't remind me. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. B3B.
Make a motion to approve the agreement with the Department of Homeland Security for financial assistance.
Second.
Motion and second. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. This is the funds that we commingle with CROG for regional emergency management services. This is a grant we do each year.
And you handle all of this, obviously, through CROG directly as our town manager, correct?
With the emergency management director, who is now Jim Ritter, yes.
Jim Ritter, yep, okay. Yep. Questions for Jeff on this? Really straightforward. Very good. Motion and second. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? B3C, emergency management grant.
Motion to approve the grant request for the emergency management performance grant. Second.
These are local dollars that go to pay our specific expenses for the EMD, emergency management director, like payroll and some supplies for the emergency operations center. Annual grant, this is, we've gotten these for the past 7-8 years.
Very good. Questions for Jeff on that? Mike Rowe.
It's $13,000 grant. If we get it every year, do we spend the $13,000 every year on supplies and salary?
Yes, we budget the expense and the revenue.
Okay. What do we get for a revenue on?
Well, $13,000.
Oh, the revenue.
It's a match. Okay. I mean, it tends to be washed.
Got it. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. Questions? Motion is second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed or abstentions? Thank you. We have two bids for A.
Motion to sign electricity agreement for participation with CROG and the purchase of electricity for 0.0794 a kilowatt hour.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Jeff?
I'm going to ask Sally to talk about this. It's a bid through physical services.
Good evening. Sally Katz, Director of Physical Services. CROG goes out to bid to solicit bids for the cost of electricity. This year, approximately 10 different communities participated in it. The bids came back slightly more than what we had been paying. It was a competitive process, and what the numbers you have in front of you do represent the lowest bid that was received by CROG. And it is for 2 years.
That's a two-year lock, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Questions for Sally on this? Very good. Very straightforward. Electricity rates. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. Thank you, Sally.
Thank you.
And while you're up there, 4B.
Make a motion to award bid for the purchase of police vehicles, 4 utility police interceptors, total $113,918, and to dispose of the 4 Crown Victorias as identified.
Second.
We have a motion and a second.
Any questions on that state bid pricing? We are moving to all SUV vehicles due to their size. The newer cruiser designs, given the equipment that we put in them and the equipment the officers wear, they are not very...
They're not suitable, and it also continues our program to remove the antiquated cars from our fleet.
This came in under budget or at budget?
About at
in our budget for the, okay.
Yeah.
Questions? Anything? Mike?
How much does our operating budget go up if we have all SUVs versus the other cars?
Surprisingly, the miles per gallon is not that different between the cruiser and the SUVs because of the way that they're driven. So we don't have statistics right now on it. It's minimal. And then as far as it may actually see by utilizing all one type of car, we then can buy parts in volume. It's the same light packages, the same other equipment that goes in there instead of having to carry inventory or purchase inventory for two different models.
Mike Rowe.
Sally, is there truly a need to get these four vehicles, the Crown Vicks, off the road? Or is it simply to get all the fleet to match? I mean, 2012 Crown Vic, yeah, 4 years old, doesn't seem, you know, that's
the Crown
Victorias, too used.
The Crown Victorias are more and more expensive to continue to try to maintain. There are also the other Crown Victorias on there are north of 100,000 miles on them. They are wildly non-fuel efficient. They're also rear-wheel drive cars. And so, no, it's not just a vanity thing of having everybody driving the same. It really is one where we need to keep our fleet from aging.
And we're going to put those up for auction?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Do you anticipate, you know, what type of revenue would we get?
Possibly between $3,000 and $5,000 a car. They are becoming less and less desirable because of the age, the amount of miles, the amount of work that has gone into them, and the fact that more and more people are not using them any longer.
Okay. Thank you.
They can only make so many Blues Brothers movies, Mike.
And one of the things, and if I may, one of the things to remember, we don't issue each officer a vehicle. They share vehicles.
Correct.
So keeping them all relatively newer, keeping them all in a higher state of maintenance, allows multiple officers to use those without problems.
You said 100,000 miles, Sally. Those are like now almost 6 years old, or five and a half. Really, it's not more than that. I would have thought there would have been more than 100,000 on them in 5 years.
Some do. Some have less. We had some that were used as a canine car, some that were used in other ways. I couldn't tell you the exact.
The exact, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Very good. Thank you for the bid. We have a motion and a second. All in favor? Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. Minutes from the meeting? Thank you, Sally.
Motion to approve the meeting minutes of October 17, 2016.
Can I get a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any changes, additions, Council? Seeing none. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Public comment. Tom?
Tom Mazzarella, 600 Walcott Hill Road. Thanks, Paul, for explaining to me some of those questions that I brought up. I still didn't get a good sense of what the vote's going to be tomorrow. Is Wethersfield's position to approve the budget as presented and work towards these other solutions over a period of time? Or I don't know how it works. Does the town council affect the vote by the four commission members that Wethersfield has on the board panel for MDC? So I got the sense that the vote was going to pass, and we'll work on these other issues later on. Is there any other comment that you can make about that? Thanks.
Thanks, Tom. Well, I will respond just I think councilors will reach out to the commissioners for representing Wethersfield and express their objections, how they vote. You know, I'm not sure, frankly. I mean, they're looking at the same dilemma from the same prism. But certainly I think they're going to hear the concerns, obviously, from the town level. Other public comment? Okay. Can I get a motion to go into executive session?
Motion to go into executive session.
Second
it. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Were we meeting Jeff in there?
Yeah, we'll go in there.